Billie Jean King always said, if you can't see it, you can't be it. If you cannot see role models in the area that you want to pursue, it's really limiting, because you can't imagine, how do you go and explain to your parents, this is what I want to be? And they say, well, show me an example. And if there's nobody there, and in the case of football, I know Steph growing up would show them, you know, she wouldn't need to show them pictures, but she'd say, I want to be David Beckham or I want to be Kevin Phillips. Well, there was no woman. There was no woman that she could say, I want to be that.
Wembley Stadium, 2012, and over 70,000 people are about to witness history as Team GB line up to face Brazil in the women's football tournament at the London Olympics.
Wembley was just unbelievable. I'll never ever forget that anthem, just in terms of the noise levels and just looking up and you're trying to find your family, and just had a great sense that it was going to be a great night for us. Kaz Carney had it and she put in a great ball, and I just decided to run in behind, and nobody was really tracking us because I don't think they expected us to be there, and obviously just managed to touch it past the keeper from a narrow angle, and to this day I don't know how I got that ball in there.
Karen Carney gives chase. Lovely sidestep to get out of the hole there, and in towards Steph Horton. She couldn't score again, could she? Yes, she could! This is incredible! What an Olympic game Steph Horton's having!
The celebration was a bit wild as well, but what a great feeling.
Steph was the golden girl, and that goal that she scored against Brazil is going to be remembered for years to come.
I think it was a seminal moment in women's football in this country, beating a country like Brazil with their great reputation, of course, and would have enhanced, I think, amongst the British public, the belief that women's football was starting to go places. And I think it was a very pivotal moment.
In 20 years' time, when women's football is suddenly the second biggest sport in the country behind men's football, and people look back and say, where did it start? Well, it started in 2012. It started then with that match.
It was probably a defining moment, that the crowd at Wembley, the result. So people were incredibly excited to feel, where can that team go, and now where can the game go on the back of that result and that occasion.
Steph Horton was the star of the show at Wembley. But this wasn't the first time that women's football had caught the imagination of the British public.
The history of women's football, and I think loads of people have no idea that it was massive in the First World War, and particularly a team called Dick Kerr Ladies, who were in Preston, based out of a munitions factory, a lot of women working in the munitions factories, where there were explosions all the time, there was TNT, they used sulphur a lot, and everybody's hair and skin was turning yellow, and really horrid working conditions, very dangerous. And the government has no objection because it needs the female workforce contributing to the war effort. The war finishes, and the football teams that have sprung up from these munitions factories are still very popular. And the men obviously came back. The FA is starting again. And they're going, women's football? Hang on, why is everyone paying to watch women's football? What's this? What's this I hear about a 53,000 crowd at Goodison? Watching who? Watching who? Dick Kerr Ladies? So there are all these letters that start appearing in the paper saying that it's unfeminine, unladylike and medically unsound for women to play football. So what, it was fine for them to work in the munitions factories and be exposed to all of that danger and explosions all over the place. That was fine, but it's medically unsound for them to play football. So the FA banned women's football on any FA-affiliated pitch, which crushed it. And the ban stood for 50 years. 50 years! And that does two things. That doesn't just say, this isn't for you, this is our game. It says to every parent, don't let your daughter play football, because girls don't play football, they can't, and it's bad for them.
Nearly 100 years on from the formation of Dick Kerr's Ladies, it's girls versus boys at South Hetton Primary School in County Durham.
You've got skills.
Such integration receives a smile of approval from a much loved and famous old girl.
Hello. You okay?
Yeah.
Has anybody got any questions?
What is your favourite memory of South Hetton?
Favourite memory is being in this primary school and waiting for that bell to go. I think at break time, lunchtime, it was always a race to go on the top yard to go and play football, and that's probably why I'm so competitive.
What is the best ground you've played at?
I'd probably have to say Wembley Stadium. I think Olympics is the best memory I've got. It was such a historic moment for girls' football, and to be a part of that was such an amazing night, so I'd probably have to say Wembley.
What advice would you give me if I wanted to play in the England team?
First and foremost, you have to enjoy playing football. Secondly would be to listen to your coaches or your teacher. And the third one would be to work as hard as possibly can.
All of the children know who Steph is, and she's so busy and we never really see her. So for her to come into school is just such a treat. It's fantastic for them. And she sat in their classrooms, played on their pitch, so it's somebody real to them. So they can aspire to be like that, and they all want to be Stephanie Horton.
We used to have a little thing where as soon as they came out on the yard, they had to line up for football, three aside or five aside, and they would get in a group. First goal would score, the team would go off, and they just loved it. And Steph and them, if they got on, you couldn't kick them off, and that was girls.
By playing with the boys, it actually made me a better footballer. It made us more competitive and made us want to win even more, because you were playing against the boys and you wanted to prove how good you were, and to the point where they actually wanted you on their team. So, yeah, I think I was the first girl to play football at this school. It was 11-a-side game, and I don't think I was meant to be starting, but managed to sneak my way on the team sheet, and I always remember on that pitch over there, we scored my first ever goal. Little Cruyff turn and then probably put in the top corner, I think. I remember my mum and dad obviously watching, all the family and all the parents, and we're over there, so feels weird to be back.
Having a sister that was better than you at football, you just kind of got to drop it as soon as that. She was really good and stood out within boys and girls, whether you were older or younger, and people in my age group would even look up to her and think, wow, she's going to be something special.
In 1997, as Sunderland AFC moved from Roker Park to the Stadium of Light, the club's women's team was attracting the best young players from all over the North East, including a football-mad nine-year-old.
The fact it was the team that I supported, I always wanted to play for them, and my all-time hero for Sunderland's Kevin Phillips, and at the time I was a striker and he was playing, and he was the one that I look up to probably the most. It was really hard to have a female role model because I probably didn't know that much about the women's game. It wasn't really well known.
One of the scouts approached us and said they were setting up an academy for girls. Would Stephanie be interested in it? So basically, I knew she would be interested in it, but it's basically fitting your day around when you work and everything. So when I went back and like saw her dad and we discussed it, and she just said yes, and we just did it.
She was very driven and very hardworking, and you know, always set her goals high. But I mean, there's a lot of people helped her through along the way, mainly Mick Malone, I would say, was probably the biggest influence from when she was like 14 up till 19, 20.
Sunderland was a hotbed of female footballing talent, and coach Mick Mulhern scouted the region for the best players available. He was to discover and give debuts to no fewer than six future England internationals.
Different players have different strengths, and Steph's was to score goals, so that's what got her sort of pushed into the first team. But that's not really what made her, if you like, a household name for England, was scoring goals. But that's how she sort of got into our team, because she could put the ball in the back of the net. And it was only later that she kind of developed as a player, pretty much in most positions on the pitch. She played in the middle of midfield, she played up front. Basically, she was a proper captain, hated losing, a real winner, and was prepared to do her job and pretty much that of her teammates as well to make sure that the team was winning or certainly weren't losing.
Alongside Jill Scott, Steph helped Sunderland win promotion to the FA Women's Premier League National Division.
I think them years were valuable in us gaining experience and gaining knowledge in order to compete in women's football. So I think a lot of credit's got to go to Mick Mulhern, but also the North East for just having that crazy, crazy football feeling.
And that crazy football feeling continues in the North East to this day. Although today's youngsters do have a female role model to look up to.
Because Steph comes from where I live, I think that I'll be able to do the same as what she does, because she inspires us.
The girls here are like more interested, definitely, and we'll all get our heads down and play. Like, there's no messing around.
It would be like my dream to play like professional. It'd be like, I want to play for England when I'm older and I'll go to America.
Steph inspires her because she's an excellent player and we'll all look up to her.
Steph was also looking up. Following relegation with Sunderland, she opted to join Leeds United Ladies.
There was lots of talk about her when she was playing at Sunderland, and it was, you know, this new kid on the block, and she's a good player, and I remember a lot of teams wanted to sign her, and when she came to Leeds we were all made up because we were like, you know, we want this new player, we want her to come and play with us, and she's such a versatile player. She came as a centre midfielder, I think she played up front at times, and then I remember first time we went away to England in the Cyprus Cup, and I think Hope Powell said, we're going to start with centre half. Like I say, she's got that versatility to play anywhere, and that's the sign of a good player. Family support is massive in football. And every time I'd see a nan, I'd think, brilliant, we'd have banana cake at the end of a game. She was the best cook ever. So she, so many times, she'd bring the cake. And I remember asking for like a recipe, and she brought me the whole cake. So I'm glad Steph didn't stay too long at Leeds, because I'd have probably been 20 stone eating all her nan's cakes.
I first started making them for Sunderland when she played for Sunderland Ladies. And then when she moved to Leeds, we used to take them through there, and they enjoyed them. But when she went to Arsenal, they didn't have chocolate cake. They weren't allowed, I don't think. You know, it was more pasta and chicken and things like that.
Steph was on the move again. This time she joined the most successful women's football team in the country.
At the time, it was the launch of the Super League, and unfortunately Leeds weren't going to be a part of that. The only club that I was really interested in was Arsenal, and I didn't really need that much convincing to go and be a part of a winning side. I wanted to go and win trophies, and there was no other team that was winning more trophies than Arsenal at the time. Highlight would be the FA Cup when I captained the side and managed to score in the first 2 minutes, and we beat Bristol. Shelley Kerr had come in and the team was in a period of transition. I was fortunate enough that she selected me as a captain, but mentally that was quite tough in terms of the amount of characters that we had in that team. Every girl dreams of playing in the FA Cup, but being able to lift the FA Cup as a captain was a dream come true.
Another dream came true when Steph became a full-time professional with the highly ambitious Manchester City Women.
Welcome to our home. Let's have a tour. Afternoon, you okay? So we'd come in here probably every morning, 8:30 for breakfast. So we'll have a look upstairs. This is where we generally eat in the morning. And lunchtime, a bit of fruit, all the healthy stuff, all the academy graduates that have come through. So, example, Mika Richards, probably the most famous one. The launch of the new women's team, MCWFC. See Tony Duggan, Love this photo, Continental Cup final win, which was a great night, great performance by everybody. I managed to get myself on the wall. It's a bit too big for that, for my liking, that sweaty after a game. A lot of the girls normally come for a little bit of a chill, table tennis, bit of pool. So this is one of God knows how many pitches that we've got here. Like a carpet. Our pitch is straight through that gap there, which is pitch number 6. The fact that it was an opportunity to go and play professional football was a massive draw, and I look forward to waking up in the morning and coming to this fantastic facility and training every day and get myself in the best shape that I possibly can be. It's allowed us to focus just on football and be coached off probably one of the best coaches in the female game at the moment.
Once the teams go professional, it means that the players train every day, so that they're working physically and they're working technically to improve their game, and I think that's going to grow the game. Fans want to see a game that is exciting, they want to see a game that is quick, and we talk a lot about the men's Premier League being the most exciting league in the world. You know, that's what we want to strive for the women's game. Steph's been a real catch for us. When you look at the boys, you know, we're in the academy building here with the women's team, and we're trying to produce boys that can go and play in our men's first team, and to have somebody like Steph, the England captain, Manchester City women's first team captain, I think that, you know, they look at Steph and they see what she's achieved in the game, and she's an inspiration for the boys too.
If they've got a poster of one of their leading men, they'll have a poster of one of their women right next to them. And that's really powerful, all of that imagery. And it's backed up by proper facilities as well, and proper coaches and proper physios and, you know, decent travel, transport to matches, all that stuff. And of course, they're getting rewarded with a much higher level of performance, but they're also getting rewarded with every player wanting to go and play for Manchester City.
We realise how lucky we are, and you know, every day that you come in, it's a reality check. It's a chance to see how far the women's game's come, and you know, I'm glad that clubs like Manchester City have come on board, and you know, it's a privilege and an honour to be a part of this.
To be captain of Manchester City is an absolute honour and privilege. There was no better feeling than lifting that Continental Cup last season. We deserved that trophy at the end of it.
As a role model on and off the pitch, Steph is able to help a charity close to her heart.
Yeah. I've had personal experiences of my family being affected by cancer through my nana and my granddad, and it was something that I strongly wanted to support, and that's when I got in touch with Future Dreams.
Well, I was diagnosed with breast cancer in March this year, 2015.
Mm-hmm.
One of the first things that I did was that I came to The Haven, and it really helped me come to terms with my diagnosis and understand what was going to be happening to me, because a lot of the information out there is for women kind of 50 plus. You just don't think you can get breast cancer in your 20s. It's not something that you think about.
Yeah.
So what we're going to do is we're all going to close our eyes.
And now see yourself in front of the sphere. If you can, see yourself happy and smiling. And cover yourself with pink light. And now that's filling your whole body, so that you're filled with love. And when that's done, you can open your eyes.
You're in such a difficult place when you get this kind of diagnosis that you don't know where to turn to, and it is a haven. Because I think, you know, it brings together so many different things that would be difficult to get on your own.
Their stories are very, very heartbreaking, but also very inspiring, and the way that they applied themselves as women and the fact that they were so strong and positive was something that I was really surprised at. And I just feel very lucky for being able to play football and to be healthy, but I want to give something back and help as many people as I can.
Oh, great. Thank you.
And so to England.
and an international career that's recently reached the highs of national captain, from the lows of career-threatening injury as a teenager on the eve of the Women's World Cup in China.
Just happened that I tried to jump over the hurdle doing bounds and just caught one and unfortunately rolled my ankle when I was on the way down, and that caused a spiral fracture of my fibula, which I knew straight away that I'd not be able to make it. So you can't really put into words how you're feeling. It was going to be your first World Cup, and that you were going to be missing it from falling over a hurdle. It was obviously gutting, but as soon as it happened, maybe a few days after, it was all about trying to get back, be better, be stronger, be fitter.
Another serious injury cruelly robbed Steph of her place in the successful England squad, which reached the final of the Women's Euro 2009 in Finland.
Unfortunately, ruptured my ACL and tore my medial. It was just one of those things, but realising how long I was going to be out probably hit us more than missing the tournament. The fact that I was going to be missing football for 11, 12 months was really hard, and two operations on a knee and at the age of 21 was not good for anyone, but my mentality was always to look forward and not back.
As a mum, I'm there to support her, like by taking her to physio and things like that, but also just to sit with her and not talk about the injury, talk about other things to try and get a mind off it and that. But she's so focused when she has had these injuries. It's unbelievable the strength she's got to get herself fit.
I think any person, let alone footballer, you know, is shaped by positive and negative experiences within their life. And certainly Steph, as a professional football player and someone who gave up her life to play in major championships and be successful, when the opportunity to go and do that is taken away or put at risk through injury, you've got to be in a strong psychological place to overcome those challenges. And Steph has not only overcome them, but she's become bigger and stronger as a result.
With those injuries and setbacks behind her, Steph became the star of Great Britain's women's football team at the 2012 Olympics, with 3 goals in 4 matches. That fortnight was to be a game changer.
It's Horton! It's brilliant! Steph Horton scores! Great Britain have the lead! And Steph Horton has the honour of scoring the first ever goal for a Great Britain's women's international team at an Olympic Games.
Since the Olympics, we got sent really contracted players through England. Clubs have taken it a lot more seriously, so we're allowed to play professional football. It's great to know that as a team GB that we were a massive part of women's football, and credit to the fans for supporting us.
Steph's rise to the very top continued when England coach Mark Sampson appointed her captain.
England captain is a huge honour and a big position within the game. You know, so Steph had to be someone who could handle that responsibility, and she clearly showed with her past experience that she can handle the media spotlight, she can handle the pressure on her, and she can live up to those expectations. And for us, she epitomised the values in which we wanted the team to epitomise. You know, she was very hard working, she's ambitious, and she's got a great amount of honesty about her. So, you know, it was certainly the right appointment for us, and Steph has certainly gone from strength to strength since she's been given the position.
To be honest, the conversation's a bit of a blur. I think it was a Wednesday or a Thursday night at St George's Park, and I think it was quite late, and he just pulled us to the side and just asked if I'd wanted to be and whether I had what it takes to be an England captain, and I actually couldn't stop smiling. I was like, yeah, of course, definitely. He was really nice and really kind, and I know that I've got the full support of him going forward.
When she got made captain of England, I think it was probably the best. That was really good. That's something, you know, you'd always wish for, wouldn't you? And there's not many people get to do that.
You'll find with a lot of leaders, they've gone through some sort of a struggle early on. They've had to prove themselves. You felt that feeling of fighting for it.
Captain of England, captain of Manchester City, you know, it's a big responsibility, but she takes that in a stride, and as the years have gone by, she's only got better with that, and I think now we're seeing the best of Steph as a captain, and, you know, it's great to play under her.
She's not one of the loudest characters, but she's not one of the quietest neither. I think she leaves the dancing and that probably is up to me and Leanne Sanderson for England. But if we need telling, we'll get told. If we need encouraging, she'll encourage.
Just a few months ago, Steph suffered another knee injury. There were fears of third time unlucky.
It was an unfortunate injury, but I got a scan and compared to reports, people were saying I was going to be out for 10 to 12 weeks and it was never ever the case, and I've been back training for however long and fully fit and raring to go. So it was always a little bit of a, okay, I maybe might miss it, but as soon as I knew, I was like, right, okay, that's my time to focus and prepare to lead this team out.
Canada now awaits. The Women's World Cup final will take place in Vancouver on July the 5th. The excitement has already begun.
Well, it's hard to describe what it's like to play in a World Cup, other than the fact that it makes you feel immensely proud and also slightly nervous on occasions. I'm sure many of them will experience that sort of extra expectation, extra pressure that comes on representing your country, especially in a World Cup. And of course, we all know in this country we do have tremendous expectations, and I'm sure that will be no different this time around.
I went to Wembley to watch the friendly against Germany, and I'd got my head full of wonderful dreams of England going to the World Cup and winning the World Cup, and the women would win the World Cup and this would be huge for women's sport and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I go and watch the game against Germany, and then I go, ooh, Germany are really good. And I know, obviously, how good America and Canada and Japan are. So you've got four teams that are probably technically better and stronger, but you never know what's... As long as England can get to the quarterfinal stage and get a half-decent draw in the quarterfinals, you can then get to the semis, really anything can happen.
Luca, she's done brilliantly. Lovely touch.
We've got some world-class players who can hurt opponents, and we've got to make sure that we play as a team, we work hard, we have a strong organisation, we stay compact, and then I'm sure then with the spirit we've got as well, you know, we can beat anyone on our day, and that's got to be our motivation.
You hope that they can get to the semi-finals. You hope that they can get to the finals and win it, because for women's football, that would be absolutely fantastic.
Horton. Yeah, of course you dream about winning the World Cup, and I'm not going to sit here and say, yeah, we're going to definitely win it, because that's been unrealistic.
Ellen White wants to lob the keeper. That's a brilliant goal.
We've got experience that have been there, been to World Cups, went to a quarter-final, and we've got youngsters that will be dying to go and taste the World Cup stage, so... It's great that we've got so many talented players in our squad, and now it's up to us to go and perform.
Certainly got a message for the English women's team, and that would be to go out there and give it your best. Don't look back and have any regrets. Give it absolutely everything. Enjoy as much as you possibly can of the World Cup experience. And, of course, one other thing, just win it.